Welcome to Translation from Outside the Metropolis. My name is Theodora Danek. I have the great pleasure of chairing this panel. I'm the Writers and Translation Program Manager at English Pen. Huge thank you to Sophie Wardle and the Free Word Center for organizing this panel. Before I say anything else, we would be delighted if you could join us later on for a focus group that will discuss further what we're discussing at this panel today. If you would like to take part in this focus group, which was organized by Lancaster University and will take place at 2 p.m., please make yourself known to us from the panel or to Sophie. Sophie is over there waving in the yellow dress. So please join us later at 2 p.m. Okay, what will we discuss today? Translation from Outside the Metropolis. The main question that we want to tackle is, does contemporary fiction media need to give more representation to the rural, the regional, to writing from outside big urban centers? Is the rural versus urban divide and the regional question, which we talk about so much in the UK, a topic in translation at all? With me to discuss this today are, from the left, Alys, a Welsh writer whose novel Pigeon was set in North Wales. Mary Ann Newman, a translator. Yes, please hold up your novel.
That's the English one.
We have the English and the Welsh version. Mary Ann Newman, who's a translator from Catalan and Spanish. And Rob Page, who's the founder and editorial manager of Comma Press. I will now each give you 5 minutes to share with us your thoughts on this topic. Alys, if you could start.
Okay, so I suppose Pigeon, the book, throws up some interesting questions. It's a book that aims to, I suppose, translate Welsh language experience for an English reader to give a sense of what it means to speak Welsh. And it's a book that was brought out for the first time simultaneously in a Welsh translation. It's a book in which there are many snippets of Welsh, and these are kind of relayed to the English reader in certain ways, but it's not a problem for English readers, as I'm assured. However, I think it does throw up the problem that that writers from areas that are non-metropolitan do face when they try to move into the publishing industry, that we find that we're working against a backdrop of a very strong rural stereotype. We find that it's very difficult to package our work and to market it, because there's a sense that rural areas of Britain are already known, and that they are very, that the metropolitan reader is all very, very clear about what they represent, and therefore perhaps not interested. I think we have to consider in this argument, what does metropolitan stand for? Should we be a little bit nervous of this term metropolitan, which I think speaks to a globalized, internationalized kind of urban center, and there's an implication that rural areas are not those things, that rural areas are not complicated, are not modern, are not contemporary, are not difficult, are not fascinating, when in fact, of course, they really, really are. We don't live in Wales, for example. Such a tiny percentage of the population lives from agriculture, and has not for hundreds of years now. And you just feel that it's about time that we were able to get these voices heard across the border. So that's my Welsh take on the question.
Great, thank you. Marianne?
Well, in Catalan literature faced the question of the urban-rural divide when it reemerged in the 19th century. It was called the Renascença, the Renaissance, and the first stages of this were romanticism, naturalism, symbolism, and it was always an exaltation of nature or talking about the perils of nature. In the 1906, there was a Catalan writer named Eugeni d'Ors who came up with the idea that what he was looking for was a new metropolitanism. And he called it Catalonia City, but the idea was to make all of Catalonia, even the rural parts, which were agricultural and rural at the time, into little civilized villages. And he would do this between by getting bookstores, by getting libraries especially, so that any farmer could go and read poetry in the afternoon or read a manual of animal husbandry, but that everyone would have access to culture. So this was the sort of nature-culture divide. And curiously, by the 20th century, by the 21st century, this has actually taken effect. I mean, there isn't an urban-rural divide in Catalonia. The so-called rural parts are the people who are devoted to agriculture are actually going to the university. You know, there are libraries and bookstores everywhere. So there isn't a divide. What there are beginning to be are third spaces that are neither rural nor urban. They're, you know, where there was a first stage of industrialization that ate into the farmland, and then you know, that now is failing. And so you have these places where there are low wage workers. There are immigrants, there are sex workers, but they're, you know, it's no longer what we think of as Alys said, as an urban-rural divide. Well, I think that's a good start, and with the conversation we'll get into other topics.
Thank you. Ron?
Yeah, well, I set up Comma Press really with two kind of burning issues in mind. One was the fact that short stories weren't really being represented, or there wasn't a space within mainstream publishing for short fiction at the time. Comma Press specializes in short fiction, that's what we do. But there was also a sense that publishing was so centralized and so kind of centered around London and the southeast and the home counties that the kind of narratives that were being sort of put forward all the time are kind of tested in London or tested in the home counties, and then if it works with the, you know, within the publishing industry here, it's rolled out for the rest of the country. And the landscapes and the cultures in different parts of England alone, let alone the wider UK, it's so different. There was absolutely no kind of representation of those landscapes. So what I did with Comma originally was I commissioned writers from some of the smaller cities across the north to write short stories that were set in those cities. And I originally began it as a pamphlet project. These pamphlets of short stories were given away free with magazines in Manchester, Liverpool, Leeds and Newcastle. So it was a very sort of deliberate attempt to give a space or a platform for writers outside of London or outside of the southeast. And it kind of snowballed from there, really. And we were very interested in the way that fiction, short fiction in particular, relates to landscapes and urban landscapes. I always say that a short story works better in cities because you've got very little time to get to know characters. They're necessarily a little bit more anonymous. You haven't got space for backstories. You haven't got space for kind of family histories. And all that kind of backstory baggage or character baggage which you have with a novel, and therefore it lends itself to a sort of more anonymous kind of arbitrary encounters between characters which happen more often in cities. So I found myself, although I was commissioning and publishing in the north of England, we actually still found ourselves gravitating towards the urban spaces because, as I say, short story sort of lends itself more to those urban spaces where you get those more anonymous kind of encounters. So it's an ongoing issue, and we've developed a few kind of possible strategies for addressing this problem of rural representation. But meanwhile, our book The City series has gone abroad, and we've commissioned books of anthologies of short stories from 10 cities so far. We did Leeds and Liverpool originally, full length books, and then we've done places like cities like Dhaka and Gaza, Rio, Istanbul. So some big metropolitan literary centres, and then some smaller town, some cities that are perhaps not associated with literary output, like as I say, Gaza and Khartoum. We did an anthology of Sudanese stories in translation last year, which was turned out to be the first English translation of Arabic Sudanese short stories. So, yeah.
Okay, thanks all. I think before we go any further, we need to define the topic a little more. When we say we want to talk about literature from outside the metropolis, what are we talking about? Are we talking about language? Are we talking about dialect? Or are we talking about the rural or the region, whatever the region is? I wonder what your thoughts are on this.
Well, in the case of Catalan literature, it's mostly the language, because there are Catalonia, well, Catalan literature is Catalonia, the Principate, North Catalonia, which is the south of France, Valencia, and the Balearic Islands. And the thing they have in common is the language. But there is the definite metropolitan pull in Barcelona, of Barcelona, which is sometimes resented by the other parts of the Catalan-speaking territories. Catalan literature right now is because of the incredible work of the Institut Ramon Llull, it's beginning to be fairly well represented in English and in the United States in particular. Not in particular, in England and in the United States. Unfortunately, sometimes the books don't travel from England to the United States or take a long time to get there. But the issue that we're dealing with now, I think, is now that the books exist, how do we get people to review them, understanding the context that they're written in? And I wondered if, when you were talking about Gaza and Rio and all of this, if this is perhaps an issue also for lesser-known literatures from other countries. You know, you never see 10 Catalan novels on a table together, and often reviewers don't understand, for example, that the Gray Notebook by Josep Pla is a contemporary with Private Life by Josep Maria de Sagarra. So, you know, how many generations is it going to take before these books can be reviewed in such a way that their English-speaking audiences will understand where they belong?
I think it's complicated in a Welsh context because we have both languages operating together, and neither is the urban language particularly, and neither is the rural language. It's not a straightforward division between urban and rural there. I think what maybe people would have thought was an issue of translation, they're realizing is a cultural issue beyond language now, that it's not just Welsh language authors that are struggling against this problem, it's also all the English language authors of Wales are having the same problem. So it crosses that linguistic divide. Language is an issue, but it's an issue, I think, which particularly encapsulates a problem that is beyond language.
Yeah, I would agree with that, actually. I think urban spaces are spaces in which people sort of agree on a lingua franca, a common language, and what distinguishes different writers and different communities is rather their history and their stories rather than the language which they maintain so much. So I think it's and if you try and define like regionality in England according to its dialects or its accents, or I think you get into very sticky water, because I think you're essentially kind of confirming and continuing some of the preconceptions about those places. And as you were saying before, both the smaller towns, smaller cities, and also the rural communities in the UK are much more cosmopolitan than we think they are. So we should avoid a sort of identity politics of the regions.
I also think they're far more challenging than we think they are. So I think the metropolitan viewpoint has far more anxiety about rurality than we can acknowledge. So we really struggle with the idea that our rural hinterland, and I speak because we're all torn between this metropolitan viewpoint and a rural viewpoint. We internalize the metropolitan viewpoint in rural areas as well. Mm-hmm. But you know, we struggle with the idea that our hinterland is not a green and pleasant land. We really struggle with that. We're not able to face up to it fully. And we both want it to be that way, and we're kind of bored by it. Because we don't want, you know, and particularly people living in urban places tend to feel that way, I think.
One of the things we discovered with some of the books that we did in this series, in particular the Book of Tokyo, was that a lot of writers, when it came to the short story, a lot of Japanese writers write about going home from their city to their village, and it's you know, the classic story of the return, returning to the family, returning to the childhood home, etc., etc. And it's in danger of being a slightly romanticized view of both the past and home and rural environment, and I think we do enter into this strange dichotomy of the modern and the cosmopolitan is now, and the urban environment, whilst the past is simple, singular, innocent, etc., etc. But if you just look at like the family, your own family tree, it goes outwards in the past. It doesn't, you know, you're the end point. You're the singularity here. Your past is very, very diverse, incredibly diverse. You know, more than you can possibly know. But we don't have that sense of the past, and we don't have that sense of smaller communities. We have this ridiculous stereotype that, you know, everybody's the same, everybody knows each other's business, nothing happens, etc., etc., and it's all very innocent and charming, when it's not.
Or sinister. The writers I've translated have been kind of radically urban. I've translated Kim Munzo and Josep Maria de Sagarra. Sagarra was writing about the incredibly modern Barcelona of the 1930s, pre-Civil War. And when Munzo, of course, was writing about 80s Barcelona and the kind of flowering of... One of them was before the dictatorship and not anticipating it, and the other was after the dictatorship and just, you know, when everything became very exciting. And a lot of the people who are writing now, that for a while there was a kind of urban model or mold, you know, where people... I don't know if we want to say they were imitating Munzo, but there was a lot of Barcelona-centric literature with, you know, very sexually active and things like that. And then now there are a lot more books that are reflecting this back and forth between the city and the small town people. And which is a fact in Catalonia. People are continue. There is a relationship of the people living in the city with the towns they come from, with the, you know, the countryside where you might, maybe you go to pick mushrooms or go fishing, you know, or your grandmother's there. But there isn't a separation. It's a small country. You can get to wherever it is, you know, very, very easily, and people do. So, and that is now part of the literature.
It's interesting, though, I think also, because as in Britain, perhaps the countryside is a place to go on holiday to, a place to enjoy, not a place to work in, not a place to struggle with. And maybe that can be a problem in the way that we receive literature, I think.
Alys, I wonder if you could tell us a bit more about how your novel was received and the specific context that you found yourself in with a novel set in North Wales.
Okay, well, I should say I called it Pigeon, partly because I knew it was going to be pigeonholed from the outset. The central character is called Pigeon, and there's a lot of things about homecoming. We've talked about home and rurality, so I think that's kind of interesting. I was aware, firstly, when I was writing it, that I was writing into a context in which this was going to be difficult. I attempted, you know, as a fairly young writer, I was tempted to throw metropolitan places at it and try not to write about the place that I'm from. Failed completely. And eventually had a complete novel. And I was told by people that they loved it. I was told that the Welsh in it was a problem. And I was told that its Welshness was a problem. And I have been told since that in... sitting in a group with other writers in workshops that our work would be more universal if it was set across the border. This is how deep the problem goes, because some stories are more universal than others, and Welsh ones intrinsically are not, which makes me obviously very angry and I think is completely untrue. In fact, the reception of the book by English readers has been excellent. They usually get the response, their favourite thing about the book is the Welshness of it and the language. So I think there's also an issue here with underestimating readers. Mm-hmm. And I do worry that structurally within the publishing industry, we have a situation where, you know, agents are anticipating what publishers are going to be resisting. Publishers are anticipating what readers are going to be resisting. And this means that we pigeonhole readers more and more into boxes in which they are not able to accept other kinds of voices. And that does really concern me. I mean, actually, I'm quite happy with what has happened with Pigeon. Parthian Books took it. They embraced the its Welshness, brought it out simultaneously, the first time this has happened in Welsh, and made it a selling point. And it's had a really big cultural impact, I think, you know, in its own way. Having said that, it's taken a long time for anything to percolate across the border. It was just longlisted for the Dylan Thomas Prize, and suddenly people are saying, oh, you know, what's this book? Why hasn't it been reviewed? And it has been reviewed. It's been reviewed everywhere possible that it could be reviewed within Wales. It's been on every single platform. It's been, you know, it's made the biggest splash it could possibly make within Wales. It has done so well. And it's only just beginning to percolate at all across the border, and I think that's a huge problem.
That's an interesting. There have been mirror effects for Catalan literature as well. For example, Jaume Cabré is very, very popular in Germany. He became a bestseller in Germany. Thank you. Thanks. And he, as a result, his books then became bestsellers in Catalonia. And the same thing happened with Uncertain Glory by Joan Salas, as translated by Peter Bush. It became a very big seller and got really, really good reviews in the UK. And people who had never read it in Catalan started looking for it and reading it. So suddenly it had a boom in sales in Catalan, a book that had been written in the 60s. So it's curious what kind of phenomena occur as a result of somebody else is recognizing the book.
I wonder if we can take Alice's experience and apply that to literature and translation. So if we think about the international context and the challenges that translation faces when looking at literature that isn't from a metropolitan area. So Marianne, your example, for example, or Ra, your experience with translated literature. Do we get enough writing translated into English from those who are not writing in a majority language in the country, or those who are not based in the capital?
I don't know if you want to. Yeah, obviously, I think it is a real problem. There are lots of initiatives to help the translation from minority languages, so that's had a huge effect. And we published Empar Molina, a Catalan writer, thanks to that. And once you get across that border, I think a lot of what we're talking about is problems or challenges of marketing and the way you package writers. And a lot of the time, the processes, the challenges, the linguistic challenges are not paramount in the reader's mind. They're not something that general readers are that interested. Empar Molina's book was called I Love You When I'm Drunk, and it's a very, very funny sort of series of stories about relationships, and it had the best title, and we gave it a really good cover, and it sold out like that. It did really, really, really well, and every Valentine's Day it's like the antithesis of the anti-Valentine's Day book, and it still sells well. And we didn't kind of put the fact that it was a Catalonian book first. We didn't talk about the fact that it's a translation. It's just funny, sassy, original, etc., smart. And I think that's the problem, really. There's so much sort of in the background of a book. We can sometimes worry too much or think too much about the fact that it's a book in translation or the fact that it's a book from a small language. It's the content, really, that ultimately the reader is interested in, the subject matter or the approach or the technique, etc., etc. So a lot of what we have to do when we make a decision about a book, whether or not to take it on, and also how to package it, how to present it, is this the challenge of just connecting with a general reader. If you know our Polish, you know, we're doing a Polish book later this year. If we just think about the Polish community in the UK or the diaspora, second generation Polish community, it's far too small a market for us to make a success of it. And likewise, if you're publishing from the regions, if you know, I'm from Derbyshire. Does anybody know anything about Derbyshire? Probably not. Great. If we were presenting a book from Derbyshire, if that was the, you know, the regional identity of the book was that all we traded on, there'd be no market, because there's about 10 bookshops in Derbyshire. So we have to find something else to connect to the average reader, and that's the challenge.
Mm-hmm. I agree that many of the things that challenge Catalan literature challenge all of the lesser known literatures, and sometimes it can be Polish or Hungarian. I mean, I think people don't specifically not know about Catalonia. Most of us don't know about most of the countries in the world and don't have the literary and historical context to be able to appreciate them. So there is the place where the translator's knowledge of the context of the book should be very useful to the publishers, because we are the ones who know where the book lands in the history, what are its salient points, what makes the author interesting. And I think there should be a lot more conversation with publishers about how to look for the hooks that will make the book resonate with the audience. Do you have that kind of dialogue with your translators?
We do, but there's a point where we have to also have a dialogue with our own kind of our own team and how we present books. So it's a combination of obviously what produced that book or the context that produced it is really, really interesting and vital, but then when it comes to translating that context, if you like, in terms of the marketing and the way we position it in the market, it's another editing job. It's another case of picking out details or similarities or kind of synergies, really, yeah, with English readers. Mm-hmm.
Go for it. I think one of the things that minority language cultures actually have that makes their work perhaps more universal and that is overlooked is precisely their experience of what it is to be minority, to be a minority. Mm-hmm. And this is something that is just not exploited, I think, in marketing terms as well. I think those connections are not made. You know, that is quite a universal experience, in fact.
I think that's an absolutely brilliant point, actually. Often writers try to second guess their audiences, and you get them writing stories which are set in some kind of mid-Atlantic averaged out city, which feels a little bit American, feels a little bit British, and they kind of miss it totally. And there is a weird paradox where the more specific you make a story, it could be from an obscure part of Northumbria, it kind of gives it an authenticity or a feel that it's, you know, that it is genuine.
Which is where it's so dangerous when we're making writers feel, yeah, that they should not be writing about these very specific contexts, yeah, because I think you go through the specific, you go through the local, and that's how you emerge at something that is more universal, mm-hmm, in fact.
But if you dig down into that, it's also a very interesting, because a writer like Kim Eun-soo, who is very urban and very, you would think in a sense he's been influenced by American writers, you know, and of course by Latin American writers and by other Catalan writers, but you know, he feels very modern, and yet for a long time, it was hard to get him translated into English because there was a kind of mirage that I got a lot of rejection letters from, for example, from Paris Review, I think it was, who said, well, there's no psychology in these characters. And why? Because they're, you know, it, as you said, they're more anonymous. They're short stories. They're talking about a different kind of milieu. But in American short stories, we have a lot of psychology. And so that, you know, actually, which is one of the things that's so interesting about his stories, that this allegorical distance and irony was very hard for a lot of publishers to accept, because they wanted it to be more American.
Yeah, and what we get instead is a neutralized world literature that is set nowhere and everywhere at the same time. And the literature that we get in translation that is located in rural areas is placed into exotic or orientalist stereotypes that we all recognize, but we would presume we'd like to see something else.
Yeah, and I think those exoticized, orientalizing stereotypes are actually profoundly damaging rural areas because they're unable to have a conversation with themselves either. I mean, particularly in Wales, we're protected to a certain extent by the language. We have an independent publishing scene and we can have conversations with ourselves at least about what it is to live there. But I do think in other parts of the country, places are really starved of this conversation. They're unable to talk to themselves, let alone to metropolitan areas, about what it means to be from that place. And they're having to internalize an idea of what they should be. And it's vastly different from what they're experiencing every day. And that's very dangerous. And I think we're seeing a lot of anger and a lot of political response to that situation in Britain at the moment.
And I think it's different if you look at the English landscape and the Irish landscape. There's a lot of great writing about small communities, which I think, literary society in Ireland. I'm thinking of writers like Frank O'Connor or John McGann, who are held up as the greatest, short story writers in the Irish tradition. And they're writing about small communities. And there's no sense of this being some kind of quaint, slightly innocent and naive kind of community. In England, we've othered it so much that the kind of the iconic stereotypes of the small communities are horrific. They're things like League of Gentlemen, Wicker Man, Straw Dogs. None of these are good stereotypes to start with. It's either held up as incredibly innocent or incredibly dark and backward and inbred and all the rest of it.
Which is also a production of the anxiety, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think we run the danger of applying stereotypes from the UK to other countries, and especially the topic of regionalism, which is not a topic to the same extent in other countries. So in the context of my home country, Austria, it's a federalist state. Everything is kind of rural. Everyone, the biggest industry is tourism. So tourism lives off a stereotype of the rural, and the publishing houses are not all based in the capital. But if publishers are looking for structures that they recognize from their home country elsewhere, they run the danger of rejecting a majority of what is interesting about literature in other countries.
I think that's a really brilliant point, actually. And I think we have to be very vigilant of just how historically entrenched in Britain, in particular, the relationship between the town and the country is, and how that is. It is a very, very complicated relationship that has been made more difficult yet again by the sort of the colonial reach of the country, and the fact that Britain has really displaced its idea of the country to the colonies as well, so that we're now approaching the writing from other places around the world looking for the same kind of exotic thing that we've always been looking from the countryside in Britain, and then subjecting the writing of other countries to the same idea.
Marianne, maybe you can provide an American perspective to this.
In rural urban, and you mean it's Trump and is that? Well, I think that there isn't really that much rural either, but the backlash in the United States has a lot more to do with these failed industrial landscapes And it's curious because in terms of Catalonia and Spain, I think, you know, if you look at the map of Catalonia as the color map of the political parties, there isn't a right-wing presence. It's right-wing presence in Catalonia is very vestigial, and the part of the conflict now that there is between Catalonia and Spain has to do with this kind of neo-fascist political party, the popular party that doesn't want to have an interlocutor in Catalonia. So, you know, I think that there are many different binomials involved in this. And in Catalonia, you have a center-right party that's basically social democrat, social Christian democrat, and fiscally conservative, but socially very liberal. And there is no equivalent to that in Spain. And it affects the literature, and it affects the publications, and it affects the way people receive the literature as well. But there, once again, to the extent that you could say in the United States you have this hinterland versus the coasts, in Catalonia you don't have that within the country, but you do have it within Spain.
If we just grasp the nettle for a moment and talk about politics, Brexit and Trump, because I think that's what's behind this question and this sense of disenfranchisement. I think the danger is we've all fallen into the same agenda and talking the same language as the Brexiteers and the Trump supporters, which is a language of us and them. It's a language of identity politics and how us, where whatever us is, has been misrepresented by them, whoever they are. It's fundamental to the. It was fundamental to the Scottish independence referendum first time around. This idea of the Westminster elite. Nigel Farage now talks about the M25 elite. Like there's 8 million people living in London, and they're all horrible. It's just an absolutely ridiculous argument, and we have to stop saying that our identity is somehow affected by our location now. We have to trade on these identities. And what's paramount for Alys is that she's a Welsh writer, or what's paramount for me is that I'm a publisher from Derbyshire or whatever. It's just ridiculous. And we have to look beyond those definitions of identity to other interests and commonalities and common histories, which are not geographically defined or nationally or regionally defined. And that's the only way in which we can move forward, because we can't, like within publishing, we can't wait for the publishing industry to become kind of cellular and distributed. So there's a regional kind of Midlands publishing scene, and there's a Northwest publishing scene, and there's a Northeast publishing scene. It just is not going to work like that because of the numbers aren't there. So we have to just change the way we talk about these things, I think.
If we change the way we talk about these things, how can we do this practically? How can we, as a translator, writer, publisher, and me who works behind the scenes for literary diversity, actually work towards making the literature more diverse?
It's really lots of ways. I think one of the things that's interesting about this is the way the word globalization has moved. 10 years ago, all the lefties were anti-globalization protesters. You know, the anti-globalization argument was a kind of green politics, left-wing argument. Now, anti-globalization is the phrase that's used by Brexiteers, Trump supporters. And I think one of the things we need to do is kind of interrogate these phrases and the language a lot more. And as a publisher, I'm really interested in histories that are not told to us, which are partly regional, and they're partly class-based, but we don't really know our own history. I'm in the middle of working on a book about the history of British protest, and very, very well-educated people, including myself, didn't know about half the protests that are coming up. And like one of them is the language for Welsh language protest that Ned Thomas was involved in, that was a movement which was incredibly closely linked to the anti-nuclear movement, and it was also linked to the civil rights movement in America. And there's all these other kind of links which are very, very international, very cosmopolitan, but we just don't know them because we don't talk about them. And it's dangerous that we all flock to the same narratives, which are media-driven and London-centred in that the media is based here. It's not a deliberate thing, but it's just a consequence of the structure of the industry. So we need to kind of reteach ourselves history, I think, and recent modern history.
I think we have to be careful when we're talking about trying to find a common language, trying to find places where we have things in common and messages that appeal to each other, that what we're not talking about is kind of railroading everyone into a very comfortable kind of commonality where actually all our cultures just become kind of neutral, you know, preferably in the city or something, because that is not what we're talking about here. I think it's quite interesting that the Welsh language area that I'm from, where we have a very high percentage of Welsh speakers, did not vote for Brexit, because we actually find our identity is best expressed within a multilingual, multicultural Europe. So just because we are very attached to our own identity, it really does not result in a sense of otherness and othering other people. In fact, the opposite, I think. We have to know and understand who we are in order to even begin that conversation.
I was struck when I saw Fences, the film, that we haven't really seen recently that many portrayals of African-American working class, for example. I think this is another time where specificity is what gives the work its richness. You're not sort of some kind of a notion of, you know, a general... I think a lot of... journalism and chronicles nowadays are telling the experience of the sort of the people who feel left behind. You know, the attention is beginning to be paid to the heroin epidemic in the United States, for example. But I don't think that hasn't quite made it into literature yet. I think that it is true that literature has been turning its back on this. You know, the writers haven't been coming out and talking about the problems that have created this radical divide between the middle of the country and the coast, so to speak, or between the white community that feels that it has been left behind and that the future of the country doesn't reflect their reality and the privileges that we are used to having. So, you know, that is something that has to emerge in literature, but we also have to make sure that people will read it, you know, because you once again might have the people on the coast reading it and not the people whose lives it's reflected.
It's really interesting that in the States, these stories are being told first by filmmakers, documentary makers and filmmakers,
yes,
rather than writers, because tradition, I don't know, like historically in Britain at least, it's been the writers that have told these stories, mm-hmm, first rather than filmmakers or, you know, the BBC or anything like that.
Yeah.
So is it a case that you think that literature and publishing in America is actually way behind the curve on this?
It could be. I think it may take longer, you know, for it to percolate down into publishing. But I think that has happened in Catalonia as well. The third spaces I was referring to, there's an incredible Catalan film. It's what they call a creative documentary. It's based on people. It has real people from a town in it. But at the same time, it's Mollet de Vallès, and the filmmaker is from that town. Her name is Neus Ballús. That film has defined this problem in Catalonia in a way that the literature is taking longer to do.
I guess that's also a question of power structures and what actually makes it into the published form, because it's not enough to write about it, it also has to be published, and that's a topic that we haven't even properly addressed. But I think now we have to open up this discussion and invite questions. We have a roving microphone somewhere. It is in the back. So if you want to raise a question, please raise your hand. If not, I'll ask more questions.
Don't be shy.
Hi there. It's Owen. Thank you so much for this really stimulating panel. I want to pick up on something you said about...
Could you stand up and...
Sure.
It's hard to hear you.
How's that?
Yes.
I want to pick up on what you were saying about the historical creation of our kind of image of rurality, specifically in Britain, when you were talking about the colonies and kind of exporting that rural image. I kind of think of it the other way around, that our image of the rural in Britain is so defined by this need for a kind of perfect green and pleasant land to come back to, kind of in opposition to this colonial expansion, that we're doing it for this perfect Britain. I just wonder if you want to say a few words about that.
I think you're right in a way, and I think we need to think of our rural areas as a green and pleasant land, so that we can also not really think about what we're actually doing to the rest of the world, and the fact that London, say, is not built on our green and pleasant land at all. It's built on far more difficult things to digest than that. So yeah, I think you're right, actually. Thanks for that.
Hi. As people that work in translation and as translators, today we've had the Man Booker International Prize long list announced. And we've seen only 3 of the 13 authors that are longlisted are women. But at least 50% of the translators that are listed are women. And I was just wondering, in your work, have you observed anything to explain that disparity between the women who are translated and the amount of women working in translation?
Yes. So this is a huge topic for us at English Pen. Just to explain a bit more about what I do, one of the things I do is I manage a major translation grant called Pen Translates, which gives support to publishers to fund their translation costs. And we have noticed for years now that there's a huge disparity in applications and in wider publishing as a whole, in women being translated and then women translators. It's very difficult to address this topic without addressing publishers yourself and addressing the power dynamics of what goes on in the publishing industry and how publishers buy, because publishers buy often from agents. So it's not necessarily just the publisher's fault. It's the fault of where they acquire and what they acquire and what actually makes it to them. So in a way, we have to start with the source countries of the literature that is being introduced to them, but also it's about raising awareness of what voices want to be heard. And I think we can all recognize that the male story is still seen as the universal story that sells. It's, even if you look at the long list of the Booker that you mentioned, the books on it are often by very famous international male authors. And I've mentioned before this neutralized notion of world literature that speaks to something that we presumably all have in common. And I've seen us the male experience, and obviously that's something we want to change, but it's a long struggle, and if anyone has a magic solution to it, please let me know.
No magic solution. Zadie Smith said she, somebody asked her why she had devoted her latest novel to women, to a friendship between women, and she said, well, when I started writing, my models were that the important thing was a relationship between a man and a woman, and that's the novel I wrote, and now I don't have to write that novel. So.
I would really recommend you seek out an article called Sexism in Literary Prize Culture, which was published on the Literary Hub, I think more than a year ago. And I think about it all the time, and it does bring up what is rewarded and awarded in prizes as well. And then also what women writers have to write about to win a prize? Do women writers win prizes if they write about women, or do they win prizes if they write about men? And again, repeat something that is seen as the universal experience. So it's a really deep issue, and thanks for bringing it up.
I just wanted to respond to the previous question and just, yeah, just line it up and do a quick plug, which is to say that are you hearing me?
Yeah. Better.
The University of Warwick has just launched a new literary prize for anyone who's not heard about it. It's the Warwick Prize for Women in Translation. It will be awarded for the first time in November. So it's for a book that has been translated into English, written by a female writer. The translator can be a man or a woman, it doesn't matter. It's open to fiction, poetry, literary non-fiction, and children's and YA literature. And we hope to get lots and lots of entries, so please tell your publishers if you've translated a book by a woman in the last year, and encourage them to send it in. Thank you.
And thanks for raising it again.
Woo!
It's a brilliant message.
That's the start of the magic wand.
Do we have any more questions? No? Okay, if not, then thank you all for coming. Can I say again, if you want to discuss this further, then please join us at the focus group at 2 p.m. Make yourself known to me. This will be hosted by Lancaster University, and there will be book vouchers, so do come along. And thank you all for coming.